I believe that there are a number of more exciting and interesting, you know, opportunities that are coming up for the banking sector, or I would say for the financial sector. So the first one is there is increased kind of liberalization and opening up of the financial system to many actors. So this has been witnessed in the past. For example, for the first time, the Ethiopian government has allowed for full liberalization of the capital good finance sector, which is called the leasing sector, not to just diasporas, but for any foreigners. Yeah. So this is a big milestone. The other thing is, as has been discussed in this morning, there is also a permission from the government side in terms of allowing foreign nationals of Ethiopian origin or the Ethiopian diasporas to invest in the banking system. That's also another improvement. And there is also the WTO accession that has been going on. So from all these angles, one exciting opportunity I would say is that, you know, the country is opening up its financial system on a gradual but kind of cautious manner, and every stakeholder within the ecosystem has to tap this opportunity in terms of, you know, translating into to the wider community. So that's one thing. The other thing, even from the innovation perspective, I will touch upon is that, you know, for the first time, as per the recent legal amendments that have been made, the financial institutions have been defined in a broader term. So that is to say that previously, when we are talking about financial institutions, basically we are talking about limited institutions like banks, insurance companies, but microfinance institutions. But right now, what digital financial service providers, or what you call fintech companies, are included in the definition of financial institution. So this is also a big jump, and the issue will be, should we give them adequate space to innovate and operate their business, or should we be sticking to the kind of approach that we have been, you know, adopting? You know, first there has to be regulation, and then the operation should follow. So I think there has to be some kind of adjustment in terms of, you know, the regulation not being a roadblock and a kind of a thing that will prohibit, you know, the proliferation of innovative products and services. So I, as a central banker, my thinking is that, you know, the first thing is, financial system or financial institution is not like any other business. So that we have to appreciate, you know. If you're asking me what is the biggest asset of a financial institution, I would say that public trust and confidence is the biggest financial asset that any institutions that have. And it will take so many years to build this trust. And eroding this trust will be kind of, it can be eroded within a minute. So from that perspective, we do appreciate that, you know, there has to be a kind of strategy, you know, to promote this innovation, but it has to be kind of cautious and kind of more careful manner. So from that angle, digital financial service providers are allowed to be considered as a financial institution and to do their business. But on the way forward, I think I like the idea of the regulatory sandbox approach, where, you know, any innovator, they have to be permitted to do their business, okay? And under a regulatory kind of watchdog, they should be like seeing what they are doing, and kind of parallel intervention has to be there, and then the regulation should come after allowing, you know, enough space for the innovators to, you know, innovate and practice their innovation. So this kind of balanced approach will be very much vital, especially for the financial system, where we cannot compromise, you know, public trust and confidence, because this is a serious business that they are in. So the other thing is, the other major kind of regulatory change is in terms of, you know, diversifying the financial institutions that we have in the system, right? So far, we were having only banks and insurance companies, but right now we are having what you call interest-free banks, that they are coming up to the picture. So they can provide, you know, their services either in window or full-fledged approach. So this is also a big milestone. The other big jump that we have in the financial system is the adoption of IFRS, International Financial Reporting Standard. So in order to, you know, introduce and implement the capital market that we are envisioning, and also to allow, you know, free movement of resources across countries, there has to be kind of standard accounting policies that has to be there for the banking system. So from that angle, I think the financial system will benefit a lot. So these are basically the main developments and changes that have been taking place in the financial sector. Coming to the challenges, the thing is, like, so far, luckily, we don't have a failed financial institution. We don't have a failed bank or insurance company that has posed, you know, systemic risk to the country. But the question is, what if? What if a bank fails? What if an insurance fails? Is the central bank ready in terms of entertaining those failures is the issue. So from that angle, there has to be a mechanism for addressing problem bank resolution and crisis management system. So that is one challenge that we must address in the near future. The other thing is, this morning the state minister has been addressing, you know, the need for acquisition merger taking place within the financial system. So the central bank has to be also ready from that angle in terms of, you know, effectively entertaining the issue of acquisition, merger, and the like. The other challenge that we must also address is, so far we have been really, you know, focused on micro-prudential supervision. So what I mean micro is that, you know, we focus on the stability of individual financial institutions. We have to really, but we have to really cater on the macro aspect, on the macro-prudential supervision aspect. So what's going on the real sector? The economic growth, the change in price of real estates. So whatever is happening in the real sector is going to affect the financial system. So we have to be very prudent in terms of knowing how, you know, the development that's happening in the real economic sector is going to affect the financial institutions. Should be, you know, priority for the future. And the other big challenge that we must address is the issue of financial consumer protection. So far, all the interventions have been addressed on how are we going to make our financial services accessible to the public. So we have done a lot in this regard, though it's not perfect. But on the other side, you know, in order to protect the interest of the consumers of the financial services, the central bank recently has included, you know, this on its mandate. So from now onwards, protecting the interest of financial consumers is the responsibility of the National Bank, and for that, the Central Bank has to do a lot in terms of really, you know, making sure that, you know, the financial consumers are served in a diligent and a responsible manner. So this will include issues like disclosure, responsible financing, and a number of other issues. So basically, these are the major areas that the government and the central bank has to deal in the near future, so that it will overcome the ever increasingly kind of dynamic and, you know, changing financial system that's unfolding in the country.